Jazz genius Marcus Johnson joins us today to talk about music and books, along with Lasava Tidwell. He's here to tell us about Morgan's benefit for books. And later, we'll introduce you to two local designers you can see at the 30th Annual Artscape Festival. I'm Sarah Caldwell. All this and more on this edition of 11 TV Hill. With rising costs of tuition and books, many students just need help, plain and simple. One of Morgan State University's alumni group teamed up with award-winning jazz musician Marcus Johnson and jazz great Gene Carney with a benefit performance. He joins us today along with Lasava Tidwell. Welcome to you both. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, this is a pleasure. How did you two find each other?
Actually, through a gentleman by the name of Tracy Wiggins. We've done some business before in the past on the community front. So I've also performed a couple of times and spoken at Morgan State University. So it's just kind of a natural fit.
And why was this partnership so important to you both? Go ahead, Lasava.
Oh, well, the partnership is important because it's for the benefit of raising money for books for the students at Morgan State University.
Okay.
And that's our primary goal.
And definitely, I mean, having a law degree and an MBA and, of course, obviously an undergraduate degree and then being a professor, for me, books and the idea of giving students access to education is key, because I know that my education is the thing that differentiates me from a lot of other musicians and business men and women. So I can't think of a better cause.
And let's talk about your music a little bit. How many albums total? 14?
14, 15, yeah. And we just put out a, with the changing times, where we consider ourselves to be kind of innovators at our new company, Flow Brands. And we just put out a flow pack with my Parisian DJ buddy and producer, Young Pulse, and that came out yesterday. So 14 in three songs. How about that?
Awesome. Well, your latest album, This Is How I Rock. Yeah. How does this one differentiate from the others?
Well, you know, it's one of those things where I grew up in D.C. So on one side, you have the hip-hop and the urban influence and go-go music, if you know anything about D.C.
Absolutely.
And then growing up in the suburbs, it was a whole different thing. So a lot of people, they are always talking about, well, I want to be funky, I want to have my street cred. Well, I just have that being who I am. But when my mom used to pick me up from school, I used to listen to one of these stations like 97.1. So I know more words to Kenny Rogers songs and Ann Murray songs than I probably do Jay-Z songs.
How about that?
So I figure if we can, if everybody else wants to, you know, take care of their street cred and their urban cred, I'll take care of my suburban cred.
All right, and you're going to help take care of that with the benefit for the books. Lasava, tell us more about that.
The benefit for books came about as a result of the Morgan State University on campus alumni chapter. And we were putting our heads together to try to determine what would be best for the students at Morgan State University. And so we thought that the benefit for books would be a good idea, because it's a way for us to connect and continue to connect with the students of Morgan State University, as well as give something back to the university.
And tell us about your time at Morgan State.
My time at Morgan State started in 1972. I'm a 1976 graduate of Morgan State University.
Thought you were much younger than that.
Yeah, everybody says that, and that's a good thing so far.
You talk about 1972. Where was I?
But you know, it's kind of funny, Marcus, that I think I read something where your one of your first concerts, where you said you got interested in music, was as a result of a concert your father took you to featuring Earth, Wind & Fire.
Yes, sir.
And I may have been at the same concert.
The Capitol Center, baby.
Wow.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you
that
go.
Was it.
There you go.
Marcus, so, what's so universal about music?
It is the one thing, I guess when you do some reading, no matter how broad a vocabulary is or a language is with words, it's still limiting. Music in and of itself, especially forms like jazz, they don't have the words, so you can actually get beyond a literary meaning, and then you can get towards a spiritual meaning and just a vibe. And you know, I was in Paris, or actually I was in Cannes, France, and I had an older couple come up to me and they had tears in their eyes, and I thought I had offended them with my music, and they're like, we haven't heard music like that in 30 years. And for me, that let me know that there is no limitation on the way that music, jazz, whether it's urban or not, can affect somebody. And then it also lets people know that there's somebody else going through what they're going through when you do mm-hmm. add the words, whether it's love or whether it's you know, heartbreak. Mm-hmm. And when you have somebody that you feel is sharing that experience with you, it's just mm-hmm. such a better feeling.
Yeah, and there's really been a resurgence of jazz lately, with young people especially. Why do you think that is?
Because I think they're looking for something that's not in the music of today. I mean, mm-hmm. you can turn on some of the hip-hop stations, and I love the stuff, you know, I'll blast it when mm-hmm. I want to feel like I'm still young, and get my head shaking a little bit.
But don't you think it's lacking lyrically these days?
I do.
Yeah.
And creativity. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, when you're talking about, well, I can't go into some of the things that they say in some of these songs, but... Mm-hmm. It is. It gets back to like the songs, where's the love, mm-hmm. you know, yeah. where's the romance, where yeah. is the I'm looking you in your eyes, where yeah. is the I have your back, where is the we can do this together, we can do this as a community. And that's the kind of stuff mm-hmm. that I got out of Earth, Wind & Fire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And Lasava, how do students get selected for assistance?
Students get selected for assistance and through the Office of Financial Aid.
Okay.
And we'll tap that office and find out who the students are. And then we will award from that point.
All right. And any more background you want to give us on benefit for books?
Well, what I like to say is that something that Marcus alluded to, we wanted to put this together as a way to define music and kind of remember how we were in school with the laid-back type of lyrics and the music with Marcus Johnson Project mm-hmm. and Gene Kahn.
It's going to be pretty cool to perform for your hometown audience, huh?
I can't wait to kill it. I would be there.
Yep. You're going to. Thank you so much. I think I'm going to have to be there for sure. And I appreciate your time, both of you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Good information. Stay with us when we return. We'll meet the mastermind behind Denya Fashions. Don't go away. You're watching 11 TV Hill. It's sunny and hot in Baltimore, and Dyanne Marte is showing her hot summer collection at the 30th Annual Artscape Festival on July 15th through July 17th. Welcome, Dyanne. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
This is a pretty big thrill for you, huh?
It is. It is. It's one of my favorite shows.
Tell us about your summer collection.
Oh, it's wonderful. I love it. It's one of my favorite collections that I've designed so far. I've utilized many different fabrications. I'm really a cut-and-sew knit jersey designer, mm-hmm. but I decided to just... stretch myself and stretch the limit, and I decided to design a couple of woven pieces. I have a cotton sateen suit, a tailored suit. Mm-hmm. I also have a super lana wool short suit. I've also designed rompers and a monokini.
Okay. Well, I've looked at your collection. It is fabulous. Yeah, I'm going to have to pick up a few things myself. What are mm-hmm. your signature pieces, would you say?
Oh, my signatures are definitely my wrap dresses and my wrap tops.
Okay.
Definitely.
And we'll be seeing those at Artscape?
Yes.
Good deal.
Yes.
How did you get into fashion designing? How'd you get your start?
Oh my gosh, I was 12 years old and I started just playing around with the sewing machine. My mom had a sewing machine. She always stitched all my clothing wow. when I was a kid. And she's always done seamstress work as well. Mm-hmm. And then I started playing with patterns, and I used to love G-Street Fabrics when I lived in the Montgomery County area. It's like the largest. They had the most beautiful fabrics and textiles I've ever seen. It was always a field trip for me. Hmm. So I had a love affair. That's when it started.
And I'm sure you probably look at other designers and you may get inspired by them. Which ones inspire you the most?
Oh my goodness, I love Cacharelle. Mm-hmm. I also love Tracy Reese. Mm-hmm. She's definitely an inspiration for me. Marc Jacobs and Chanel mm-hmm. is a classic. Definitely.
Cool. How would you describe Baltimore fashion compared to, like, say, D.C. or New York?
Baltimore is definitely a crowd, or like it's a segment within itself. What I love about Baltimore is that everyone in the population loves wearing color. So I see different color combinations, and also I feel as though there are definitely trendsetters. There are a lot of trends going on. And I kind of like to look to street fashion just to get a sense of what's going on and then how I can interpret it for my customer, mm-hmm. Which is definitely not an older clientele, but my clientele is basically between the ages of 25 and 40, established, educated. They're a little bit more refined. They like classic, but they also like classic with a little bit of edge.
I think that's very true. You're also a college instructor.
Yes.
You're a busy lady.
I am.
Where do you teach, and what inspired you to get into that as well?
Oh, I love teaching. I teach at Bowie State University and also at the Baltimore City Community College. I've been with BCCC for the past 6 years. And I actually, it was a happenstance. I was working with a Troika costume shop, and back in 2005, one of the graduates had mentioned BCCC. My education, I've actually gotten a design management degree from Pratt Institute, so I have my master's. That's what you need in order to teach at a college level. Mm-hmm. So she introduced me to the right people, and I started teaching.
And how have the students responded, and what did you learn growing up that you've passed along to them?
Patience, and also, yeah, just patience. Everything comes in time, and take the time to just enjoy the process.
And where did the name Dyanne come from? I was curious about that.
Oh, it's an anagram of my name. My spelling is Dyanne.
Gotcha.
And I just kind of switched things around a little, and I wanted something memorable, and it's worked so far.
All right. Well, we're looking forward to seeing you at Artscape. Again, what specifically are we going to see in terms of your designs there?
I'm actually wearing a new wrap dress. It's a mock wrap dress. Thank you.
And wrap dresses are really popular these days.
They are. They work with so many different body types. They're easy to take care of, easy to wear, easy traveling. I mean, you can just throw it in a bag and go. And a lot of people just respond well, my customers especially. And I've been trying to reinvent my wrap dress. And it's 6th year? I've been designing it, so now I have a mock wrap, and I've been able to become even more creative. And I have about 10 versions of it so far.
Okay, that have come up with. I'm going to have to look for that. What else will they see at Artscape?
They're going to see some of the spring, summer collection. I've kind of sold out of most of the items already.
Well, good for you.
Thank you. And then also just easy pieces, a lot of color, different color combinations, some funky things.
What I like about your fabrics is you can wash them easily.
Yes.
They're not necessarily going to need ironing.
No, they're not.
Wash and go.
Yes.
Yeah, and that's what people need these days. Like, who needs the dry cleaner and all that?
No.
It's just too much.
No, and the chemicals aren't good either.
Yeah.
Not for you or the environment.
Yeah, exactly. Where are we going to see you a few years from now?
Oh, that's a good question. I hope I'd like to get back into wholesaling, probably in a few stores again. Also consulting. I love consulting, and I've come up with a new website where I'm just putting together trends. So that's kind of my pet project.
Wonderful.
I don't know how I have the time, but I do.
I was going to ask, how do you possibly have the time to do all this? Well, it's nice to have your hand in a lot of different things.
Yes.
Well, it's been a pleasure talking with you,
it's
and good luck
too.
With the show at Artscape, and
I
hope you get a lot of interest from folks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure. And stay with us. Local jewelry designer Deborah Soromenho is here to tell us about her designs. Don't go away. You're watching 11 TV Hill. Now that we've seen the outfits, let's look at some accessories. Deb Soromenho doesn't do the same thing twice, which is why we're so excited to get a sneak peek today at her designs. Welcome. Thanks so much, Deb, for being with us.
Thank you.
So we hear about metalsmiths, and we think of maybe horseshoes or something, but that is not what you specialize in. You specialize in really beautiful jewelry. You know, you describe it as artsy, worldly, earthy. Mm-hmm. What other words would you use to describe it?
It's kind of like an urban chic style. Mm-hmm. So it's things that are nice jewelry made with, good metals, sterling silver. I do work with copper and bronze also, but for the most part, sterling silver. Jewelry that's going to last, that you're going to want to wear over and over, not so much trendy for you that you wear for one season. But that's different, has a little bit of an urban edge. It's not your, what you think of traditional jewelry, something that's a little bit outside of the box, so to speak.
Yeah.
So that's kind of in the style. And with the term metalsmith, I think a lot of times people do, kind of get confused with that. Horseshoes and things of kind of blacksmithing. Mm-hmm. Metalsmith is more of a smaller scale.
Gotcha.
I call myself metalsmith because I do mixed metals, but really I use sort of the traditional techniques of a goldsmith or silversmith.
Okay.
And it's just that I work in mixed metals. You sort of generalize the term to be metalsmith. Mm-hmm. But you know, in those techniques, you know, working with the soldering torches to put the metals together, all the different tools and hammers to you know, mold and form the metal, mm-hmm. to, you know, be in the shapes and everything that you want.
Yeah, I want to talk about that process a little bit more, but let's first go back and tell us how you began, how you started and got into this career in the first place.
All right. It was actually a little bit of a fluke that it became a career. I mean, I have an artist background, so I've done a lot of different things in art, from illustration to website design. But, you know, never anything that was really wonderfully happy with. And I, at one point, but I've always done jewelry just kind of as a hobby. Mm-hmm. And at one point, I kind of wanted to just take a break. I was going to help my husband with his business and just, you know, make some jewelry on the side. Mm-hmm. But I started working with the metal, and, you know, I bought some tools, some hammers, and I started just manipulating the metal. And I found that I absolutely loved it. It was just remarkable to take just a piece of wire or a piece of metal and, you know, be able to form it into, you know, beautiful jewelry, into any shape that you want. I mean, you can make metal do almost anything, yeah. in, you know, with different processes. So I kind of just, you know, said, forget, you know, you're on your own, hubby, and, mm-hmm. and went on my way, and just, you know, I started just getting more and more into it and doing more of the sheet metal and trying different techniques and buying more equipment and tools, which is really fun. I find myself where, you know, always before I was like, hammers, who wants hammers? Now I'm like, yes, give me hammers
right.
and anything to be able to do
so
things.
So you've done
metal.
A lot of experimentation along the way to really arrive to where you are now.
Definitely, definitely. Especially in going with the you know, the bigger metals and things. I started out with just wire, mm-hmm. Which is fairly simple to manipulate. But when you get to the bigger metals, it takes a lot of experimentation, and there's a lot of things that go completely wrong, mm-hmm. and you're like, wait a minute, this is not what I expected. And so then you, you know, you kind of just try different things to get what you want. But a lot of times you come up with something new that you really love and didn't expect. So that's a good thing, too.
So take us through the process. How are these beautiful pieces of jewelry made?
Well, it does depend on the piece. Mm-hmm. But something like this piece, it's a large piece of metal. That I would start with, and I would, you know, other than working out the design, and I would, you know, use a sketchbook like a traditional artist to mm-hmm. kind of, you know, work out designs and shapes and things like that. And then I would transfer that onto the metal, and I actually use a jeweler's saw, mm-hmm. Which is like a little hand saw with really very fine blades that you saw out the shape. Mm-hmm. And then this piece is there's no soldering involved. Mm-hmm. But in other pieces, I would have a soldering torch, which is kind of like a smaller version of a plumber's torch or something,
okay.
To where you have the gas and it comes through and you have the little flame that comes mm-hmm. out. And so that's quite a process in itself if you need to do soldering to a piece. And then different hammers make different textures. You have a lot of different finishing tools with different, you know, I guess, grains of sandpaper and that type of thing to get different finishes.
So how many hours a day are you dedicating to this, typically?
You know, it absolutely changes up. I mean,
Well, you're a mother as well.
Yeah,
so that.
I'm lucky enough to be able to work at home and do this at home. So my hours can go anywhere from, you know, a couple hours a day, because that's just all I have time to, you know, as much as I can fit in a day besides, you know, when my son is home and he needs dinner and he needs help with homework and things like that.
Exactly. You have a lot of juggling going on right. at home. Now, your jewelry actually went to the Emmys recently. What
yes.
a thrill.
Yes.
And who was wearing it?
Well, it's actually not in yet. It'll
okay.
be in this year's Emmys, which is in September.
Okay, gotcha.
So right now it's just in the preparation mm-hmm. of Emmys. And the pieces are, and its earrings going into the Emmys gift bags, so like the swag bags that
oh,
the celebrities
wonderful.
Get.
How did that come about?
I actually am involved with a group, an artisan group, that sort of hand selects artisans. Mm-hmm. And at this point, it's handmade artisans. So this is all people that, you know, hand make their own designs. And so we'll be represented by them. So I don't actually go myself.
Okay.
Which, I don't know.
But your jewelry gets
yeah,
to go.
My jewelry goes, which is awesome. So we'll see. I mean, all of, you know, the celebrities that will be going through the gift lounge will, get a bag with my earrings in them.
That's major.
Yeah, it's so exciting. I mean, it's one thing to, you know, have the celebrities there. We'll probably get pictures with the celebrities with my earrings. And then I'm just hoping to, at some point later, see them walking down the street with my earrings on.
That's wonderful. Wow. What do the earrings look like? What are we going to see?
The earrings that are going in are my large teardrop, copper teardrops. Okay. So it's a larger sort of bold statement piece earring in hammered copper. And they've been aged, so they have just like a little bit of an urban look, but not, you know, so far out there.
I'm okay.
Definitely, you know, a statement piece. You know, they're earrings that you see when you're
walking down the street. And will they be appearing at Artscape?
They definitely will be at Artscape. I have a sterling silver version of those also.
Okay.
And they'll both be there along with.
What else will we see there?
All my pieces that I have in the range are going to be there. And I do have earrings in the $20 range.
Great.
Just like simple, you know, wire earrings, mm-hmm. All the way up to, you know, $100 to $200 pieces that are more one of a kind and, you know, artistic pieces.
And how does it feel for you to be part of Artscape?
I love Artscape. This will be my second year. I was there last year. And it's just such an exciting place. I mean, Artscape itself is just a perfect environment for artisans. But even Baltimore as a whole, I feel, are just, you know, so supportive of artisans and mm-hmm. Independent artists and things like that. And it's just the whole environment. So everybody there wants to see these independent artists, wants to, you know, just be involved in it and help the artists in their business and things like that. So it's great. I'm very, very excited to be back.
And you're from this area originally or not?
I'm from Maryland.
Okay.
So I don't live in Baltimore, but I live in Bethesda. So
okay.
Very close.
Excellent. Well, it's great to have you back.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to seeing your designs at Artscape.
Great. Awesome. I'm so glad.
A lot of people are. Thank you so much.
Pleasure
talking with you. And don't go away. You're watching 11 TV Hill. Thank you for watching 11 TV Hill. If you'd like more information on today's segment, simply visit our website, WBALTV.com. And as always, stay tuned to the news that's live, local, and late breaking. I'm Sarah Caldwell. Have a great day.